Father, we thank you because thus far you have helped us since we came from the beginning of this Congress. You have been speaking to us through your word, by your spirit, as you have sent your servants unto us. And we thank you because of the way you have ministered to our hearts. Thank you for the decisions we have taken. Thank you for the prayers we have prayed. Thank you for the experiences we have received. Thank you for the challenges that you have granted us. We thank you for our response to the word of God. And we thank you because we're going back stronger than we came. We bless your name for all your servants that you have used. We thank you for the preachers, for the ministers. We thank you for those who led us in seminars. We thank you for the Bible study sessions. We thank you for the members of the choir and the orchestra. We thank you, Lord, because you prepared them for us so that they can minister to our needs. And even though we've heard them sing before, we see a new anointing on them. And we see the word coming forth with anointing and power sinking deep into our very hearts. Lord, we just pray that all the instruments you have used in this Congress, in any area and every area, we pray that all the anointing we have seen on them will multiply and abide on them in Jesus' name. We thank you for our brothers and sisters as we have fellowshipped together in the hostel and around the worship center here. Father, we thank you for the love. Thank you for the unity. Thank you for the understanding, the agreement that we have with one another centered on the word of God. We pray that such love, unity, harmony will continue in our midst in Jesus' name. Blessed our ears for what we hear. And blessed are our eyes for what we see. Because we never saw it like this before. Your word has come with clarity and with power. Even those of our brothers and sisters who were on the fence before, now they have come into the center of the kingdom of God. And those who are outside the fence, looking within, wondering, what do these people believe? Why are they praying like this? Why do they appear like this? How is it they're so peculiar like this? These who have been outside the kingdom, looking over the fence, we thank you because the reality of the joy and of the goodness of the Lord upon our lives has drawn them into the kingdom as well. We thank you for those who have been saved. Thank you for those who have been sanctified. Thank you for those who have been baptized in the Holy Ghost. Thank you for those who have been healed. Thank you for those who have been delivered. Thank you for those who have been challenged to respond to the call to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Oh Lord, we pray every vow, every consecration, everything we have uttered from our mouth to say unto you in this Congress will never go back from them in Jesus' name. We pray that day by day you will renew the strength of your people. Lord, as we go back, we pray that your power will go back with every one of us in Jesus' name. For those who have experienced persecution at home because of parents or guardians that will not understand, how we pray that you follow them home and your glory will cover them and protect them in Jesus' name. For some who had been told that they shouldn't come to this Congress, but because of the pull of the Spirit of God, they couldn't stay behind. And they are wondering when they go back home, what will happen? Oh Lord, we just pray that before they go back home, you control every situation at home in Jesus' name. We pray, oh Lord, that those who came to this place battered in life, confused in life, discouraged in life, those who came here and then it appears that the devil was after them all the time, every corner of the way, wanting to destroy them. Father, we thank you because now greater is he that is in them than he that is in the world. And therefore we know that the devil will not be able to overcome them in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, that everyone goes back they'll go back in the strength and the joy and the power, the might of the Lord in Jesus' name. That, Lord, enemies will fall before your people. That when they utter a word of authority, that word will have power over the devil, over demons, over witchcraft, over sorcery, over every evil thing in Jesus' name. That your people will not be conquered, but it will be more than conquerors in Jesus' name. Every time the Assyrians send their horses and chariots across them and around their dwelling, and they rise up, and there is a servant that says, "Alas, what shall we do?" I pray that you will open the eyes of these, my brothers and sisters, that they will know that they that be with us are more than they that be with them. And they will always be in control of every situation in their lives in Jesus' name. We have come to the climax, to the conclusion, and we're not going to look back. We're going to continue until the day dawns in Jesus' name. Therefore, Lord, we just pray that as we get into your word now, you will so strengthen us, you will so open our eyes to see your truth, that what we see in your truth will make us conquer all the days of our lives in Jesus' name. For those who are not here and they are still weak, for those who are not able to come and they are stumbling and falling by the way, we pray that as we go back and we see these people that have been shot with the arrows of the devil, falling by the wayside, we pray that you will give us the courage to lift them up. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, we pray. Let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 24. We're reading from verse 4. And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Take heed that no man deceive you." Here Jesus Christ was about concluding his ministry with the disciples before he went to the cross, and was giving them the final charge or the final challenge. They had asked him a question, and the question related to the things of the last days. And as they wanted to know about that, he challenged them to personal faithfulness to the Lord. And in this verse he said, "Take heed that no man deceive you." Then he said, "For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many." Then he went on to talk about other things that will be taking place: disturbances, disasters, wars, and rumors of wars, persecution, hatred coming from the world against the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then he told them in verse 13, "But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved." If you bring those two things together, in verse 4, "Take heed that no man deceive you." In verse 13, "He that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved." Then you have what we're talking about: take heed until the day dawns. Take heed until he comes again. Take heed until the very final end. Because he says, it's only as you endure unto the end that you will be saved. So then, it is very necessary for you to make up your mind that come what may, whatever you come across on the way, you are going to endure to the very end. You are going to give yourself over to the Lord in such a way that temptations may come, opposition may come, persecutions may come, whatever it is that comes your way, you are going to stay, you are going to stand, you are going to keep faithful and keep true even to the very end. As we consider these words of the Lord Jesus Christ, and these are serious words, important words that none of us will dare neglect, we're going to consider three subtitles in the message. Number one, serious warning for Christ's disciples. Serious warning for Christ's disciples. Number two, temptation to compromise. Temptation to compromise. Number three, steadfastness in Christ's doctrine. Steadfastness in Christ's doctrine. One, we have serious warning for Christ's disciples. You see, when you look at the Bible is complete for our Christian lives. In the Bible, we have the promises of God to stand upon. Standing on the promises of God, I cannot fail. Also, in the Word of God, we have the commandments of God to obey. Just obey, just obey. This is God's message. When the Savior speaks to you, there is but one thing to do. Just obey. And so we have those commandments, and they are there for us to obey. But then also, we have the prophecies of the Word of God. And those prophecies of the Word of God, they are things that God has placed down. And they will be fulfilled, because according to Isaiah, it says one mate shall not want another until everything will be fulfilled. Also, we have warnings in the Word of God. And these warnings we're to read, we're to take to heart, and we're to beware lest we fall into the trap of the enemy. We'll look at a few of the warnings in Mark chapter 13. Mark chapter 13. Reading from verse 5 and verse 6. Again, it's still the Lord speaking unto his own here. And Jesus answering them began to say, take heed lest any man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Jesus Christ looking far ahead. Thousands of years, hundreds of years after him. He said, the time will come when many will even profess to be Christ. Not just that they are servants of Christ, ministers of Christ, prophets sent by Christ. They will say that they themselves are Christ. And you might feel that they will not be able to deceive anyone. Jesus Christ said, they will deceive many. And so he says, take heed lest anyone will deceive you. In Luke chapter 17, we have another warning in the Word of God, coming from the very lips of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Luke chapter 17, verse 26, and as it was in the days of Noah, that is Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. It says, they did eat, they drank, they married wives, and they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. There the Lord is warning us that when he will come, the conditions of the world will be as the conditions of the world at the time of Noah. And then he said, we should be very careful that that day does not come upon us unawares. And then he continues in verse 28. In verse 28, he says, likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot. They did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, and they planted. Then they builded, but the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Again, he's telling us that we should be very careful so that day will not come upon us unawares. He says then in conclusion in verse 32, remember Lot's wife. If you remember this story, it's in Genesis chapter 19, where the angels came and visited Sodom. And Lot saw them, and then he welcomed them in. And the angel said that the Lord had seen the wickedness of that place, and that he was going to destroy all those people. And so they had something to do. They were to go to their neighbors and go to the people that were related to them, so that they will want them to get out of that place before the place was destroyed. And eventually, Lot went out and told those young men that had married his daughters. But then it seemed to them as if he was just mocking or jesting. They didn't take him serious.
Eventually, the angels laid hold of their hands, Lot's wife and his two daughters, and said, "Escape to the mountain. Do not look behind you, because if you do, there will be danger." And then they were going, and the fire started burning in Sodom and Gomorrah. Unfortunately, because where the heart is, there where the treasure is, there will your heart be. The treasure of that woman was in the world. The treasure, the heart, the interest, the desires, the aspirations, all the ambition was in Sodom, all wrapped up. And therefore she looked back and became a pillar of salt. And then Jesus said, "Remember Lot's wife." You see, there are some assemblies and organizations as well as fellowships where they have no warning at all for the believers. They say, "Well, you are saved and you are forever saved." They say, "Once you have laid your hands on the plow, it doesn't even matter if you look back at all, you will still be able to get to the kingdom of God." Jesus said, "No." He said that Lot's wife came out of Sodom, but then did not escape to the mountain. Between Sodom and the mountain, that woman became a pillar of salt. And then the Lord said that we should take that as a warning. We remember Lot's wife so that we ourselves will not fall into the same evil thing that that woman fell into. Lost her soul, lost her life. In Luke chapter 21, Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 34. "And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time, your hearts be overcharged with self-pity and drunkenness and cares of this life, so that they come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man." Here Jesus again warned his own disciples. In all the warnings, Matthew, Mark, Luke, then you realize it must be very, very important. Because you see, the Lord would not have repeated those warnings if there was no danger at all. How will you warn some people of danger if there was no danger? But then he warned the disciples and he said, "Take heed to yourself. Take heed to yourself. Lest at any time when you are young, at any time in middle age, at any time as you are getting older, at any time in the time of success, at any time in the time of failure, at any time in your undergraduate days, at any time when you graduate, at any time during your youth service, at any time when you have got a job, at any time when you are preparing to get married, at any time after you have got children, at any time when you're on holidays, take heed to yourself so that at any time your heart will not be overcharged." You see, there are people, they are good Christians on campus, but then they backslide during the holidays. You see, there are some people that will be good Christians at the time when other believers are around them. But then when all the other believers are not around, they are not good Christians anymore. There are some people that may appear to be good Christians when, you know, when a fellowship like this, we have a congress like this, and everything is going on fine, then it appears that they are good Christians, and they will promise the Lord, "I will serve you, I will do this, I will do that." But after that congress, immediately they get back home and they face opposition, and they face challenges, and they face persecution. Then they do not take heed unto themselves. So the Lord said, "Lest at any time your heart be overcharged with self-pitying and drunkenness." That might surprise you, because actually the Lord was talking to his own disciples. And you know that his disciples were not a drunkard. They wouldn't be drinking what the people of the world drink. Oh yes, do you know that although believers do not drink alcohol, there are some things that can intoxicate you like alcohol. You know, sometimes a young fellow wants to get married, and he feels that marriage is the all in all. And in thinking of that marriage, in planning that marriage intoxicates like alcohol. In fact, sometimes more than alcohol. You see, there are some people under the influence of alcohol that at least will control themselves, and they will not promise more than they know that they can give out. They know that at that time when they're under the influence of alcohol, they ought to control their language, they ought to control what comes out of them, because they might just say quite a lot. It's like when I was very, very young in the primary school, many years now, there was a man, and in fact, I still remember the picture now as I talk. He will drink a palm wine, I mean the original, not the diluted one. And when he takes that palm wine, then he will come out and he will say, all the money I've got, he will point to where it is. And the key, if you want my key, he will throw it up like this and say, go and help yourself. And as he was drunk like that, he'll be telling everything about, you know, the things that he had. And we young people will say, oh, so he has so much money. He has, that's why he kept his money. And that's what he did yesterday. That's what he did the other time. You know, that's the influence of alcohol. Do you know there are people like that? That when they are drunk with this idea of getting married, they forget Bible. They forget all their consecrations. They'll forget everything they had said before that they will do for the Lord because they are drunk with the idea of marriage. You know, there are other times that they will have your scholarship and you've been looking for that scholarship. And when that scholarship comes, you are so joyful it appears that you are drunk. In fact, when I was a younger Christian, the opportunities and the possibilities that came, there were even some believers that told me that, you know, if the devil gives you a scholarship, take it and use that scholarship and then serve the Lord. I said, that's your own policy, not mine. You see, there are people that will take anything from anywhere. And when I was a younger Christian, there were some other people, we graduated and we came out of school, and they were rushing for this and rushing for that. They wanted this, they wanted that. And when these forms came out, it was like they were drunk. They will not be able to have quiet time anymore. They were so much in a hurry. They wanted to go and get this and wanted to go and get that. And I will just stay in my place. I will say, if that thing is for me, if God wanted it for me, then I know I would have it. Because I know that God has he had a plan, and he still has a plan for my life. And whatever that plan is, it will be fulfilled. And that is why when I was a younger Christian, everything I said I will do before, I still kept on doing. I never allowed myself to be intoxicated with the wine of the world, or the wine of ambition, or the wine of marriage, or the wine of every other thing that people were having. And Jesus said, take it to yourselves, lest at any time your heart be overcharged with evil, with surfeiting and drunkenness, and the cares of life. And the cares of life. And the cares of life will be so much upon you that you will not even know how to follow the Lord consistently anymore. And then in verse 36, it says, watch ye therefore. Watch ye therefore and pray always. Watch ye therefore and pray always. Now, when it says, watch ye therefore, what do you watch? Now, it's sometimes I use some methods in teaching. I used to do that when I was teaching in my normal profession. And because of the stages that the Lord took me through in the teaching profession, I had to develop methods and attitudes and ways of making people remember what I say. And as I've come to the Christian ministry and I teach and preach, I also still do that. So some of the things I do and some of the things I'll tell you now is just the method of making you remember. I've been privileged to teach primary one when I was, after my school certificate. I taught primary two and three and four and five and six. And they always give me the subject to teach, either arithmetic or it is mathematics. All through the time, and young people find that difficult. And therefore, I look at the level of the people I teach, and then I will help them to understand what they ought to understand. When I was in the primary school, and that is teaching the primary school, and the children had difficulty because the teachers that had taught them before, They will, beat them and tell them to sit down there and cram the timetable. 9 times 1, 9. 9 times 2, 18. 9 times 3, 27. 9 times 4, 36. And 9 times 5, tell me aloud. I thought you had forgotten. You know, the other teachers, what they will do is, repeat that and repeat that, and they will take all the whole lesson, the whole 40 minutes teaching, 9 times 1, 9 times 2, 9 times 3, and those children will be sweating. When I took over that class, those children, and they saw that I was, the arithmetic teacher in the primary school, we called it arithmetic at that time, not the modern day now, they call everything mathematics. Whether they are dividing oranges or tearing paper, it's not everything, it's mathematics. I will come to the class, I would say, who has difficulty with this and that, the multiplication table, and they will, tell me that they all lift up their hands that they have difficulty. So I said, now we're not going to be very serious on this subject. I just came to, play with you in the class, and we're going to now have 9 times 1, and then I asked a very simple question that everybody understood. I said, how many fingers do you have? And he'll say 10. I'll say, stretch them out. And so they'll stretch them out like this. So I'll say, this is 1, this is 2, this is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then when I say that, I'll say, now we're going to have a multiplication timetable. I'll say, this is 1, 9 times 1. I drop this finger and I say, what remains? They say 9 fingers. I say, write that down. That's the answer. 9 times 1 is 9. I say, this is 2. 9 times 2 is what? They say, this is 1 over here, remaining 8 fingers. 1, 8 is 18. And I, drop this other finger. When I drop this finger, I say 9 times 3, how many fingers there? That's 2. How many fingers there? 7, that's 27. 9 times 4, I say how many fingers there? They say 3, and this one 6, that's 36. 9 times 5, this is 4, and that is 5, that is 45. 9 times 6, that is 5, and that is 4, and that is 54. And so, when we settled all that, I didn't have to beat them in my class. And I didn't have to knock them on the head and say 9 times 1, 9 times 2, 9 times 3. When I finished that and they are enjoying that, I said, now wait a minute. When you line up all those things, you have 9, 18, 27. Why don't you write that down? Just write like this. Just write 9 if you have not forgotten. If you have forgotten, use the method I taught you now. You have 9, you have 18, you have 27, you have 36, you have what? Then what? Then what? Then what? Don't write them down. Don't just, And then what? And then what? Okay, if you have written them down, if you look at the first row of numbers, you are going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, up to 9. Have you checked up that? If you check up the other column, you are going to have nothing there which is 0. You are going to you are going to have 9, 8, and it's going to go down in descending order. Is that right? Then, now, if you have all those 9 times this, 9 times this, 9 times that, if you take the figures there, you have 9, 18. 1 and 8 is 9. 27, 2 and 7 is 9. 36, 3 and 6 is 9. You understand that? 45, 4 and 5, that is 9. And 54, 5 and 4 is 9. Now, so when I do that with all those children, I now tell them, if you want to know whether any number is divisible by 9 or at all, just add all the figures. If the final figure is divisible by 9, that number itself, the number may be stretched out like 6 figures or 7 figures. Just add the figures together. If they get 9, then it's divisible by 9. And when I, on that lesson, I will do all my games and everything with 9. When I come to the next class, I say, now we're going to take 8. And then I do all the things I want to do. And then by the time I spend 1 week with them, those things they have been having difficulties with in the previous classes, I do my remedial kind of teaching like tutorial. And then they go over that, and now I can get over to something new. I go from the known to the unknown. That's, how to teach. And so when I came into the Christian ministry, and I started teaching the Word of God. Sometimes it might surprise you when I say number 1, number 2, number 3. I do that deliberately so that you'll be able to hang your thoughts upon this peg and this peg and this peg, so that you'll be able to remember. the word of God that you have learned. Now, I said all that to bring you to one point. I told you I go from the known to the unknown. And now the point I want to bring you to is when it says, watch ye therefore. That is in Luke chapter 21 and in verse 36. Watch ye therefore. What are we to watch? Number one, use that word watch. W. Watch your words. You see, when the Lord is telling you to take heed, he's telling you watch. What are we to watch? The first thing to watch is to watch your words. And then, what else are you to watch? Watch your actions. A for actions. And then T, watch your thoughts. And C, watch your character. And then H, watch your habits. Do you know? If you watch in those areas of your life, you're going to be a successful Christian. You're going to be a Christian that knows how to stand firm in the way of the Lord. It says, watch ye therefore. And so, you see, you're watching your words all the time. The people that have done the research, they tell us that men speak about 25,000 words every day. And women speak about 30,000 words every day. And you see, it is in the words that we speak that we offend many times. And then we regret and we say, why did I say that? I didn't think before I said that. I didn't meditate on what I was saying to know the consequence of my words. I gave that man a promise. I gave that man my hand. I gave that woman a word. I promised something without thinking through and praying through. And so we mess up our lives. So then, number one, if you're going to take heed, watch your words. Watch your words. Let your words be few and weighty. If people ask you questions, don't be in a hurry to answer. Watch your words. Then watch your action. You see, when people offend you, your action may be the action of anger. Do you know that when you have a problem, your action may be an action of discouragement? Do you know that when there is maybe any confusion, your action may be a kind of action that will just take all of a sudden? You want to come out of this situation immediately, and without knowing, without thinking of the consequence of the action that you are taking, you just take the action in confusion. Do you know sometimes when you see a person for the first time, it may be that something impresses you about that individual, and it may be lust, it may be inordinate desire, it may be infatuation, whatever, and your action. You see, you might decide, I'm going to write a letter to her, I'm going to write a letter to him, I'm going to befriend him, I'm going to do this. You see, at that first time, watch your word. When you are going to write back home, your parents have done something during the holidays that you felt, why did they do like this to me? While you are in the heat of that disappointment, don't write anything. Watch your action. You see, many things that we do, we make mistakes and we go into sin because we do not watch, number one, our word. Number two, we do not watch our action. Then, number three, we do not watch our thoughts. You see, thoughts fly in and go out. And if you do not watch what you allow in your heart as thoughts, you brood over those things, it may be thought of failure. It may be thought of impossibility. It may be thought of defeat. It may be thought over an object that is not actually right. You see something that sends signals into your brain, and the cell system there is a kind of chemical change, and it gets right into your mind and into you. And you want to watch very well. You want to watch your thoughts. Now, you know, a chemistry student, if somebody mistakenly takes a particular acid, you know, the alkali that should be like an antidote to neutralize that is the same thing with thought. If a kind of angry thought wants to come into your mind, you should know the alkali. You should know the thing that you are going to use to counteract and to act like antidote against that thing. Then you think of love. You think of peace. You think of unity and harmony. You think of the life of Jesus Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now, you watch your thoughts. If it's thought of discouragement, think of the promises of God to neutralize it. If it's a thought of anger, think of things that bring love and harmony and compassion in you to neutralize all that. Watch your thoughts. Sometimes the thoughts will develop into daydreaming. If you don't check it, right there. And then you'll just be daydreaming and you can think yourself into a bad action. You can think yourself into things you shouldn't have done. You just see it in isolation, and then you are having difficulty with that thought, and the thought is pouring in, and you have, you know, picture in your mind. Do you know that we think in pictures? If, you know, when we mention a particular word, we don't think of the spelling. If I mention sheep, you don't think of the spelling, you think of the object. When I mention a boat, you don't think of the spelling, you think of the object. When I mention a dog, you don't think of the spelling of that word dog, you think of the object. If I mention Jesus, all the time you are not thinking of, you know, the letters J-E-S-U-S, you think of the picture immediately in your mind. When I mention Jesus, somewhere in the compartment of your brain, you just picture him. The same thing, if you allow wrong thoughts into you, the wrong thoughts are going to develop into a picture. And then that picture, you see it very clearly before you, and it can begin to even affect your flesh, begin to even affect your temperature, begin to affect all your moves and every other thing you want to do. That's why you watch your word, you watch your action, you watch your thought, you watch your character. You see, you want to watch over yourself so that you will not have a kind of character that is not according to the word of God. Notice what you are going to be in life. The Lord has given you the goal, or he has given you a kind of desire that this is what you want to be. But your character can spoil everything. Watch your character, and age, watch your habits. Watch your habits. You see, if you do something consistently, continuously for about 3 weeks, it's likely to become a habit. If you begin to wake up early in the morning, and you can do that, you discipline yourself and do that for 3 weeks, it's likely to just come later just like that. If there is a difficult subject in your course, and you discipline yourself that when you are fresh in the morning, that difficult subject, you approach it. If you can maintain it for about 3 weeks, and you know you have the good books and you have the right method to study that subject, that can become a habit. Or in the same way, if there's a bad thing, and you begin to pick up the slangs of the unbelievers, if you pick up those lines and you are walking with them, and you begin to listen to their music, you begin to listen to all the things that they are doing and all the jokes they are casting, by the time you do that for 3 weeks, it may become a habit. Watch your words. Watch your actions. Watch your thoughts. Watch your character. Watch your habits. Look at that verse now. It says in verse 36, "Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man." Well, you've seen that we have warnings from the Word of God. And I pray that God will give you wisdom to keep to those warnings in Jesus' name. Now, there will be temptation. That leads me to point to you. Temptation to compromise. Always understand, it's the coward that compromises. The one that is not courageous and bold. The one that is not fearless and sticking to the word of God. Those are the people that yield to temptation. And if you yield to temptation and you compromise, it is not because that temptation is so strong. Because the Bible says God will not allow any temptation that is greater, stronger than your strength to come to you. Therefore, if you yield to it, it is not because there is not grace enough from the Lord to make you overcome. It is because you did not take heed to yourself. But the temptation will be there. In Proverbs chapter 1. Proverbs chapter 1, reading from verse 10. "My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. If sinners entice thee, consent thou not." Let's stop there for a moment. Sinners will entice in different ways. And we need to know the methods of the people of the world in enticing us to evil. You remember, for example, the case of Joseph. He was walking in the house of Potiphar. And the wife of Potiphar set her eyes upon Joseph. And while Joseph will just be doing his normal work, this woman appreciated him to the point that the woman wanted to commit sin with Joseph. You see, it starts sometimes in a neutral way. There may be an unbeliever in your class. He might just discover that you are very good and very sharp in that particular subject. And because she wants to, you know, get on in that subject, might just say, friend, do you mind explaining this to me? Of course you can. That is very, very innocent. And there's nothing bad in that. And then eventually we'll begin, you know, from the studies and from the discussions together, we'll begin to say, what is the meaning of this, your name? Well, that still looks very innocent, but, you know, it's coming nearer and nearer. And then on Monday, where were you at the weekend? How did you spend your weekend? I thought you just wanted me to help you in this subject before. This thing is developing now to, you know, becoming familiar and becoming close. Well, I went to church. I read the, because, you know, I'm a Christian. But, oh, are you a born-again Christian? All these born-again people. Well, I used to hate, you know, these born-again people because I thought that they were all hypocrites. But, you know, your own born-again, I like your own born-again. Because, you know, you helped me and you put me through in all these subjects. And if everybody that professes to be born again, if everybody were like you, I would really, you know, be born again myself. And so you think that's an opportunity to witness to this lady. And you say, well, you can be born again. How can I be born again? And, you know, you say, if you repent of your sins, what are all the sins? And then you give a catalog of all of them, the ones you can remember. And you hit her as hard as possible, thinking that if I hit like that, she's going to run away. With all the hitting, she says, well, I can bear that since I have a goal, since I have a purpose. Because, you know, if I don't bear all that hitting and everything, this man is going to run away from me. And she will say, yes, that's all right. Yes, that's all right. Yes, that's all right. And eventually, you say, let me lead you in, you know, being born again. And your leader will say, stay after me. And every word you said, she said everything after you. And then, without even allowing her to respond, that now, are you born again or not born again? You're just assured, don't doubt at all, you are born again. And she said, yes, I'm born again like you. And so the discussions will get closer and closer, nearer and nearer. And eventually she would say, where is your room number? Oh, and you will say, our brethren must not see me with, what's the matter? We are classmates together. And here is it, we're, you know, studying together. And you have led me to be born again. Will born again people not fellowship together? Oh, you say, I'm sorry. And so, you know, you allow that. And then little by little, we'll begin to say, where is your passbook and where is this and where is that? And then one day you'll just find that, you know, she's crying. And you say, what is the matter that you are crying? Well, I have a problem. I cannot just discuss anyhow. I must be sure of who I, you know, expose my problems to. You say, well, you know, we're being together. And here is it. Now you are studying the word. And she continues to weep and cry. And before you know what the devil is saying, why don't you take your handkerchief and wipe the tears away? And by the time you know what you are doing, you know that you have gone yourself. You have not won her to the Lord, she has won you for the devil. That's why the Bible says, my son, if sinners entice you, consent thou not. But you know, Joseph, while that woman was, you know, thinking and meditating and thinking that I will do this, I will do that, got hold of that young man and said, you must do this today when the men were not around. And that young Joseph left his coat in the hand of the woman and then ran away. There are times you have to take to your heels. There are times you have to run away in the literal manner so that you will not get into trouble. You see, when it says sinners, when they entice you, consent thou not. Do you know that, you know, the people of the world, they have quite a lot of methods. You remember, if you have read your Bible to that point, in 2 Samuel chapter 13, there was this young man, the son of David. We don't have all the time, that's why I'm just telling you, you can read later on your own. 2 Samuel chapter 13, from verse 1 to verse 15. And you know, this man was getting lean and lean every day. And so his friend asked him and said, what's the matter with you that you are growing lean every day? Are you not the son of a king? Oh, and he said, I love Tamar, my sister, of the same father, but not of the same mother. I love Tamar, my sister, and there is no way for me to get near her. And yet that is the reason I think so much about her that I cannot concentrate on any other thing. And I'm sick to death because of her. And so this, his friend said, oh, there is a way out of that. All you have to do is pretend that you are very sick. And then lie down. And then your father David is going to come to check up on you. And you are going to say, I'm sick and I've lost appetite. You see now, and that's the reason I'm getting so lean. And your father is going to say, well, what are we going to do now? And you know, if you just say, send Tamar, my sister, to come and prepare food for me, so that I'll be able to eat something delicious and I will not die of this sickness like this. And so David, without knowing anything, do you know that people like David can be deceived? Do you know that those who have the mind of Christ, do you know they can be deceived? Because you know, David was not even thinking about it. And we're told that David was a man after God's heart. And so he just sent to Tamar and said, go and take care of your brother Amnon because he's sick. And so Amnon innocently just went in there. Oh, my brother, you are sick? What's the matter? Well, I'm so sick. You know, I can barely talk. And well, what kind of food are you going to eat? And you know, he said that. And the lady went to prepare the food. And after preparing the food, he said, well, my sister, come and give me the food yourself, because I am so sick, I cannot eat myself. And so all the other men, that's why he said, everybody go out, because I want to eat now. And so all the people went out. And he said, here I am, my sister, come and give it to me, because I am so sick. And so Tamar came in and got the food. And the man that was sick jumped up and he was now strong and overpowered the lady. And the lady said, don't do this. This is a foolish thing to be done in Israel. And then messed up her life. And then she ran out and tore her beautiful clothes and began to cry. You see, if sinners entice you, you see, the enticement we are talking about is not, sometimes it is not direct. Sometimes it is so mischievously planned. Sometimes it is done in such a way that that individual may catch your life like that without knowing what is happening. You know, sometimes it is not even immorality alone. Sometimes they want to initiate you to a particular cult. And it is that, you know, it may be even your mother, it may be your, you know, senior sister or whoever it is in the family, because they have been saying, born again, born again, born again, born again. And then they said, well, we're going to see what to do. And they'll just say, my sister, when you were still at school, we decided that I needed to go to a particular place. And now that you have come, will you not accompany me? And watch your words, watch your action, watch your thoughts, watch your character, watch your habit. Without thinking, without knowing anything at all, you just say, well, you are my sister, you are like I am, I'm like you are. And then you follow after. When you get there, you discover it is the house of herbalist. And then the lady will just say, this is that my sister that we talked about, and we came together now. And so the man, if the man knows a little bit of psychology to pet you and to quieten you and not to be afraid at all, the man will begin to say, you know, they have told me about you, and I see your star, and I see that you are going to be very great. And there are, you know, people that are not going to allow you to be great as you ought to be great. And you see, we are not doing anything to hurt you or to harm you. And we are not doing anything to make you hurt any other people. All we are doing is to take care of you. After all, haven't you read? Because, you know, he doesn't know Bible. And if you don't know Bible, God have pity on you. He will say, have you not read in the Bible? Heaven helps those who help themselves. And that word, that sentence is not in the Bible, but because maybe you yourself, you don't know what is in the Bible and what is not in the Bible. And you say, well, I think so. And he says, haven't you read also that God has given us leaves, not only to eat, but to take care of ourselves. There is a place in the Bible like that. Have you not read that? Then you say, well, I've not. I said, well, you're a young person. You have not read the whole Bible. There's a place like that. Not only that, have you not read sometimes where it says that Jesus was writing on the sand? Oh, yes, you say, I remember that. I say, well, that's what we're doing here. All that the sand we put down and we're writing on it is the same thing. And all these leaves, we're not going to hurt you. And by the time they jumble everything together, you fall into the trap. My son, if sinners entice you, consent thou not. You see, there was another time. This is Jeremiah now, chapter 35. Just write this now, Jeremiah 35, verses 1 to 11. You see, Jeremiah called the sons of the Rechabites, and he said that you will come and drink wine. Actually, this was a test of their commitment and a test of their faith. And then these sons said, No, we're not going to drink the wine. Even though Jeremiah, they knew Jeremiah to be a prophet, they knew Jeremiah to be a servant of God. Even though he was the one telling them that they were to drink. No, they said they will not drink. You know that sometimes you will come across a minister and he has, you know, this big cross and he has a name, bishop or archbishop or presbyter or deacon or whatever, or elder. And then he will call you and tell you, how about doing this? Oh, you say, no, I'm a Christian. What? See how big my cross is? You are a Christian, what am I? Then he'll begin to tell stories. When we were in Jerusalem, then the archbishop from Edinburgh, and the lay reader from Washington, and the other one from Australia, we got together like this, and we sang, we enjoyed ourselves, and we all drank the wine. The archbishop drank, Australian drank, the British fellow drank, the American drank, and of course, I drank. And after the drinking, you see the Spirit of God, how it came down. You young people that turn the Bible upside down, that don't understand. Are you telling me that if you just take a sip, that means salvation is gone? Are you telling me that if you just drink this little cup and you don't become drunk, are you telling me that that means that you are no more right with God? All these deeper life people, that man over there that is brainwashing you, I'm telling you, you young people, don't make yourself to suffer for nothing. Here is it, you will not pay for it, drink it and test it. And then with all that confusion, you say, what am I going to do now? After all, this one is a man of God too. After all, this one is a preacher to you. After all, this one is this and that to you. You see, if you read that passage, it will show you very clearly. You do not do that because of the person telling you. You know your conviction in the Lord, and you will not accept to be tempted and to fall into the temptation of compromise. Well, I have some eight sentences to tell you briefly. Eight on one side and eight on the other side. And what I've done here, and this is part of the method to make you remember all the time, and maybe you've heard it before from me, but if you've not heard it before, maybe you want to write it down. To overcome temptation, number one, resist the devil. Resist the devil. You see, the devil will come with temptation. He will try to do this, he will try to do that, but resist the devil. Number two, renounce hidden works of dishonesty. You will renounce. One, you resist. Number two, you renounce the hidden works of dishonesty. Number three, you reject Satan's suggestions. Satan will suggest a lot of things to you. He will say, how will you know as a man that you are complete if you never go to have a girlfriend, if you never test yourself? If you have gone for prayer because you are having a problem of impotency before, if you now say God has healed you, how will you know that you are healed if you don't go to commit fornication? And also, if you say you are just like this, because you know, some women, they may not know themselves. If you do not hand over yourself to a man, how would you know yourself? How will you know that this is this and this is that? Reject Satan's suggestions. Those suggestions will come. They will tell you that other fellowships, they are doing this. Other fellowships, they are doing that. And why are you not at liberty? After all, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Now, liberty there does not mean lawlessness. It does not mean doing evil. It means liberty to do right. Liberty to pray. Liberty to love. Liberty to do what is right. So reject Satan's suggestions. Number four, refuse the sinner's invitations. Refuse the sinner's invitations. You see, sinners will invite you. Sometimes they will invite you to the end of session party. Sometimes they will invite you to a kind of social thing that everybody is getting involved with. And sometimes it's just a single man that will invite you out. You know, sometimes on Saturday, all the sometimes the school of nursing will be flooded with these boys from the other campus. And you know, as soon as it is Saturday afternoon like this, you'll find all these boys trooping in to that school of nursing. And then as you are just going your way, this fellow will come there, that fellow will come there. And this other fellow to a man, you know, maybe they brought him. They said, well, you are there, but we've been getting our own girlfriend. And the way you can do it is go to that school of nursing. And eventually you will get your own. And they have taught them what to do if it's a novice coming from the village, you know, to the campus, and he doesn't know the way of the people. So he will say, what do you say to them? How do you know all this is? So they will say, this is what to say. This is how to introduce yourself. He will write everything down. During the week, he will practice. And after practicing on Saturday afternoon, then he comes. And then he's, you know, fidgeting and, you know, because he's novice on this area of committing sin and going into the things of the world. And he finds this one. And by the time he's still standing, you know, at the court there, this other fellow said, ah, you're still there. I've got my own. Now we're going back to the campus and she's even following me. Go and try. And so this person may come to you if you're in the school of nursing. And he will say, good afternoon. How are you? You look like, because that's what they are taught him to say, you look like a born again Christian. Oh, then you don't know the trap they are setting. You say, yes, I am born again and I'm proud of it. Oh, and then he will say, I thank God I'm born again too. Oh, are you born again? Oh, yes, I am born again. And in fact, I came here, that's what they taught him to say, because it's coming from Billy, didn't know A from B. So he will say, I'm just looking for one sister who is born again, Sister Joy. And you know, they'll say, it's in this particular room. Can you help me look for Sister Joy? And you leave all that you are doing, thinking that this is a child of God, this is a born again person. You are running around looking for Sister Joy. And they say, which joy? There's no joy here, there's sadness. And then they'll come back and you say, well, I didn't see Sister Joy there. Well, in any case, what is your own name? And then you introduce yourself. And then all the other things they taught him to say, he began to say them. And then, where is your room? So that if I come here next time and I'm looking for Sister Joy, you'll be able to help me. And because you don't know what is happening, you know, you give him chair and, you know, in your room there. And okay, this is your room. That is wonder. It's good I knew you today. Are you not going to give me something at least to remember so that I will know when I come next time? And as born again people, no Coke, no Fanta, nothing at all. Okay, wait for me. And then you go and buy something. Then you are started. You are started. Because you know that is the thing they do. And they will catch you like that. And eventually, before you know what is happening, you have yielded to the temptation to be invited unto them. And they will mess up your life. Refuse the sinner's invitations. Then number five, remove all stumbling blocks. Remove all stumbling blocks. You see, if something made you fall last week, remove it. If something made you fall 2 years ago, remove that thing. Or if you see that you have been a Christian with your fellow sister had been a Christian, and this particular thing was a stumbling block to your fellow sister, in your own life, watch and remove that stumbling block. You are a brother. This is the thing that made your brother in the faith, to fall. Remove that stumbling block so that that thing will not be a problem to you. Number six, rebuke evildoers. Rebuke evildoers. I don't recommend that you do what I have done when I was in school. Because in my own case, I was led of the Lord. And you see, as many as are led of the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And I did some things that my classmates could not understand me. And they couldn't go along the same way with me. Even those who were Christians in our department at the university, they couldn't do exactly what the Lord led me to do. But I told you, don't copy me. Don't just go and do that. Because I did it, be led of the Lord. You know, we were in the final year. And our head of department, the professor, he was for traditional things. He was for cultural things. And he loved all these cultural things. And I was the only born again child of God in my own class in the final year. And so we had almost rounding up our courses in analysis and pure maths and you know, complex variables and all those things. As we were rounding up, the head of department felt that to, you know, just to relax this particular weekend, we should come to his house. So all the others, because you know, were going to take the final exam, and he was the head of department. And then before he became head of department, if you ever got into any conflict with him, even when he was ordinary senior lecturer, if you got into any conflict with him, you wouldn't take certificate out of that place. And now he had become the head of a department, the all in all. And so everybody feared him except myself. Because you see, when you fear God, there is nothing else to fear. And I knew that the Lord sent me to that university for a purpose, and I was going to make it. There was no doubt about it in my mind. And so he invited us, and we're just about 12 in that final year mathematics class. And he said, you'll come at the weekend to my house. And I said, sir, what are we going to do? What's the purpose? You don't just, you know, rise up and go to a place without knowing what you want to do. No other classmate will say that. Oh, and he said, you know, to just drink my wine and to relax and to look at the, you know, video for cultural things and all that. And after he explained all that, he said, how many of you will come? 11 people raised up their hands except me. And then, to be very sure how many of you will not come, I raised my hand, only one person. And he said, why? What's the matter? Well, I said, because I'm a Christian, you know. And as a Christian, I don't do such things. That it's forbidden. I cannot go to drink palm wine. And I don't associate in any kind of group like that. Because I'm not just a Christian, a peculiar Christian. Oh, he was mad. He was very, very angry. And he said, what do you mean? Then I explained again. He said, what kind of church do you go? I told him. He said, what is the emphasis there? And I began to talk Bible and religion. And he said, that, you know, kind of church will be wiped away in this country. I said, sir, I looked at him right in the face. I said, it's impossible. If this work be of God, you cannot destroy it. Lest by any means you are found fighting against God. You know, it becomes, you know, a very hot dialogue between a student and the head of department. I don't advise you to do that. And so don't, you know, go and do that without being led of the Lord. And eventually, you know, he was very unhappy. And whenever he came to the class, he will, you know, look at my direction if I was there. And apart from what he was teaching, he will say some other things. But I stood firm. And the other students were telling me to avoid a subject. I said, no, that's going to be one of my best subjects. And, you know, I went on like that. And as I continued like that, we took the final exam because it was a final year. And do you know that in his own paper, I think they said I got 92%. And, you know, all through all the other papers too, you know, the Lord helped me. And for that year, 1967, in the whole university, there were three of us that got first class. And among the three of us that got first class, I was the one that had the highest aggregate or average. You see, when you know that you are serving the Lord will back you up. And then I went back to secondary school to teach. And I taught for 5 years. I was never in a hurry. And when I taught for 5 years there, because that school had sponsored me, when I got first class, my principal told me, you can go back and, you know, you'll become a professor and become this. They have told me, because that professor even came to our school wanting my principal to release me so that there was automatic scholarship. And I said, I wasn't ready yet. And that man got angry again. And then eventually, after 5 years, I came to the University of Lagos here to do a postgraduate in education. And we had a particular lecturer. He too, when he came to the class, he was talking about women. Talking about this and talking about that. And again, listen to me, I don't advise you to do exactly what I did. Because nobody told me to do it. It's the Spirit of God. And one day, he came to the class like that, and he was talking all this rubbish. And I raised up my hand as if I was going to ask questions. And then he gave me attention. I said, sir, this is a class of adult people. And there are some of us who are intelligent enough to know that this is not part of the course. And I do not allow this anywhere I am because, you know, I am a Christian. And when I said that, he got angry. And he said, what? You a student in my class? You are going to control my class? I said, not so, but these stories are not part of the course. You're wasting our time. You come to the class and, you know, all this rubbish you are telling, are we going to write that down as part of our notes? And so he was very, very unhappy and he left the class. When he left, all the other students jumped on me. And he said, you bring religion into the class. What's the matter with you? If you don't like a subject, then go out. I said, no, it's my right to be here. And I'm not going to go out for him. So he came back the following lesson. And he was loaded full. with immoral language, bad things. And so when he came to the class that day, that's after the first encounter, and he started his stories again. And when he started his stories, I raised up my hand. And then he was good enough to give me attention. When he gave me attention, I said, this is what I said last time, that this is not convenient for me, and that they irritate me. I don't enjoy them because I'm a Christian. And then he said some other things. When he said that thing, then I packed my books and everything, and I went out. And you know that the following week, he had a disagreement with the provost at that time, and he left. When he left, then they said the subject was no more compulsory. He had set the paper, he had done everything. Now, after he left, then they said that he had, the paper was no more compulsory. We took that exam, and once again, God gave me distinction. And when I got the distinction, then I just walked to the provost room one day, and I said, I didn't write application to lecture at the University of Lagos. I just walked in, and I said, sir, I have a feeling that next session I would like to change from teaching in secondary school to teaching in university. And he said, well, welcome you, you can come in. That's how I got to the University of Lagos to become a lecturer. When they looked at the results, when we finished that exam and had got the distinction, then that lecturer settled with the university and came back to the university. And when he came back, he was lecturer, I was lecturer. You see, you take your stand that you will not bow down to the devil, and you will not accept anything that is evil. Now, methods will change, approach will change. And many of you in universities at this present time, you are so young, but you know, those of us at that time were not so young, when we were at the university. So we had some level of maturity and some level of approach. And I've told you, don't just go and copy what I did, because if you do, if you are not led of the Spirit of God, and you'll say that this is how the GS did it when he was here at the university, and then you do it, and then they summon you to the Senate, and then they suspend you, then you get a letter from your region or from your campus to come to me in Lagos to say, sir, I did what you told us to do, and I got into trouble. No, I didn't tell you to do that. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are what? The sons of God. So then, rebuke evildoers. Number 7, restrain your tongue. Restrain your tongue. You see, if you're a real Christian and you are going to overcome temptation and you are going to overcome all these evil things, restrain your tongue. Number 8, refrain from bad company. Refrain from bad company. Resist, renounce, reject, refuse, remove, rebuke, restrain, and refrain. Now, another set of 8, but all these positive. Number 1, remember the Lord at all times. Remember the Lord at all times. You see, when temptation comes, remember you are a child of God. Remember the Lord has called you, and remember the Lord at all times. Number 2, receive the word as God's word, not the words of men. Receive the word as God's word and not the words of men. Number 3, rely on the strength of the Lord. Rely on the strength of the Lord. Difficulties may come, oppositions may come, persecution may come, temptations may come. You rely on the word, on the strength of the Lord. Number 4, reckon yourself dead to sin. Reckon yourself by faith, reckon yourself dead unto sin. You just tell yourself, I can't do that, I'm a child of God. I can't smoke, I'm a child of God. I can't go on hard drugs, I'm a child of God. I can't go into immorality because I'm a child of God. Because I make up my mind, I will not do it, I cannot do it, I must not do it. You reckon yourself dead indeed unto sin. Number 5, remain in the congregation of the righteous. You see, what will protect you is that you remain in the congregation of the righteous people of God. Don't miss meetings. Be very closely associated with people in the fellowship. with the children of God. Let your best friends be the people of God. Of course, it's not that you are keeping the other people outside as enemies. But make sure that the people you confide in, the people you are intimate with, the people you can share heart to heart with, they are the real children of God who have the same purpose in life, the same goal in life, wanting to honor the Lord, wanting to glorify the Lord all the days of their lives. Remain in the congregation of the righteous. Number six, rejoice in the Lord always. Don't rejoice in evil. Don't rejoice in iniquity. Rejoice in the Lord always. Whatever is happening, no pocket money, rejoice in the Lord always. The joy of the Lord will be your strength. Or it is that you have failed in a particular subject. Don't allow that to mean final failure, total failure, permanent defeat in your life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Don't take a wrong direction and do a wrong thing because of the low mark you have got in that one single subject and say, I will not serve the Lord anymore because of that disappointment in that one single subject. Rejoice in the Lord always. And when you rejoice in the Lord like that, you'll find prison doors opening and breaking down as a result of your joy in the Lord. Number seven, renew your vows and consecrations often. Renew your vows and consecrations often. Do you know that it was when I was still at the university that some of the principles of life that helped me later and that is still helping me today, I took my decisions at that time. I remember when I was at university in my undergraduate days, I had my own timetable as we were taught, the time for quiet time, the time for my studies, the time for tutorial, the time for library work, and the time to do my assignment, and the time to do extra reading, and the time to practice my music, and the time to read Pilgrim's Progress, and the time to read the Bible, and the time to read Christian literature. I put everything down. And anybody who knows me knows that till this day, I still walk by timetable. And you know, I still have to do that because if I don't do that, I will not be able to do everything. You know, you need time management. I still do, you know, my normal timetable. And I still know when I do a kind of study that is church history. I know when I do my kind of study that is expository study. Not just writing it for Monday Bible study outline like I do here in Lagos, but studying for myself. I still have to learn about goal setting. I still have to learn about missionary work. I still have to learn about a lot of things. And I still keep to a timetable that at this time I'll study about this. At this time I'll study about faith. At this time I'll study about deliverance. At this time I'll study about the doctrines of the Bible. At this time I'll concentrate on some books of the Bible. You see, I developed all that when I was at school. You see, some people, when they become pastors or they become leaders, they then live a kind of flabby life that is not well under control. But if you have taken vows and consecrations at that time, when you were still at school, now if you are out of school, you still continue to renew your consecration and your vows. In fact, I still remember the time and the place. When I was in UNILAG, it was an evening like this, and I just went to that place at the lawn, and then I began to pray in the evening. And right when I was praying, the Lord assured me that I was to stay back in Lagos, I was to come and lecture in Lagos, I was to do this, and then I was to establish, you know, this deeper life. Everything was very clear to me. It was at that prayer time. Because I know the way the Lord had been dealing with me and leading me, that's why it is very difficult to get me out of working with a timetable. If I didn't keep a timetable, when to pray, when to read, and when to converse. You see, when I was a student, I would not allow another student to impose himself upon me. If you came and you wanted to discuss with me, and it wasn't a free time on my timetable, I'll just say, I'm sorry, I can't do that now. I wouldn't go to any discussion with you. I wouldn't do anything except it fell on the free time. And I'll just tell you, come back another time. And you know, I still do that today. I still look at my life. And sometimes, you know, there's a lot of pressure. If you are ever at the Central Church, you will know. You know, sometimes there are people, there are a lot of people. If I was supposed to leave about 2 or 2:30 after I've done all that I felt I ought to do, because maybe the next thing I should go and do is to go back home and, you know, prepare an outline and do this and that. If I stood up and I said, for today, I've finished, All the people, just, you know, some of them may cry, some of them may say this and that. I'll just say, well, I'll see you tomorrow and see you another time. Now it's time to stop what I was doing now. And when that is stopped, then I will go. And so you see, you need to know how to walk to a timetable like that. Renew your vows and consecrations and then redeem the time. Redeem the time. Well, if you do all that, you will discover in your life that by the grace of God, you are able to overcome the temptations and whatever else may be in your life. Point number three is steadfastness in Christ's doctrine. Steadfastness in Christ's doctrine. Well, to really live the Christian life, you have to be steadfast and make up your mind. We end up with Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he will not defile himself with the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. So you make up your mind, you'll be steadfast in all the things you have learned. All the word of God, all the doctrines, all the teachings that you have learned, you will not play with them, you will not joke with them. I believe that is what has helped my own commitment. Personally, what I believe will help your own commitment. I know that the word of God is true from cover to cover. And I will not allow anything, anyone to make me deviate. I'd rather give up anything, 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 and give up the word of God. And people who have known me have known that that is the attitude I take. I was invited to the United States to come and have a particular program that will be televised all over. And they had made a lot of publicity. But then I realized that they were not going to take the word of sanctification and holiness. And then I wrote to them, I said, I'm sorry, I cannot come. Because what is on my mind is not what America wants to receive. And so two people came from there. They wanted to do other things in Nigeria. They came on Sunday to our fellowship in Lagos here. And they said, hi, about this invitation and this and that. I said, I'd written already, I will not be able to come. And then they said, but why? We're prepared for you and we'll pay for the flights and everything. I said, I'm sorry, because you heard the message this morning that I gave in church. I can't preach that in your place. You won't accept that. This is the very heart of the message of the word of God God has given to me. And I'm not ready to travel that length and become and be talking about testimonies and this one and that one. It is holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. And they tried to persuade me that I should accept, because, you know, congregations are different. Those people also want me to be able to do a little good. I said, I'm sorry, I don't have time for that. And I rejected that. You see, some people are not able to take their stand to say that this is where I stand. And by the grace of God, I will not change. And I pray for you that you will stand on the word of God in Jesus' name. Rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer.